second talk of Dr. Ross will be on human-like implemented AI and human problem solving AI. So this will be all about artificial intelligence. So software engineering, electrical engineering, electronics engineering, and all engineering courses. You would be affected by AI, because AI is supposed to be what is the in thing, or what would be is in the future, and it would even encompass all engineering fields and courses. And so this will be a very interesting, and this time a more technical presentation talk of Dr. Ross McBride.
Alright, so I'm going to do a completely different talk now. It's going to be on artificial intelligence. We're going to do a little shorter version, since people's attentions are probably waning at this point. This talk is called AI and the Function of the Mind. So I spent many years working on both the problem of understanding the scientific structure of consciousness and the problem of artificial intelligence. I spent a long time working at a think tank called the Lexington Institute, where we attempted to lay out every fundamental claim that has ever been made about artificial intelligence onto these maps. And so each box on the map represents a claim that someone made about artificial intelligence, and the lines connecting the boxes represent other people supporting that claim or disputing that claim. So if you want to get up to speed on all of the debates about AI, I recommend getting a copy of these maps. They're really cheap, instead of spending the 10 years that I spent reading nothing but AI articles. Okay, main claim of the talk is that we will never build real AI, that is AI that works the way a human brain works, and until we are able to understand how human cognition works, and then figure out how to replicate it. This is based on a paper I just published called Human-like Implemented AI and Human Problem-Solving AI, which sounds complex, but it's really simple. Human-like implemented AI is just AI that solves problems just the way humans do. So it's real AI. It's AI that works just the way a human brain works, right? And then problem-solving AI is just AI that solves problems that we happen to be interested in, but not necessarily in the way that we solve them. Right? So, for example, an autonomous driving vehicle uses lasers and sonars to detect objects around us in order to navigate through the world. So it's navigating through the world, which is a problem that we're interested in. So it's problem-solving AI, but it's not doing it in the way we are doing it, so it's not real AI. Okay. I want to talk about a little bit of the history of AI and AI enthusiasm, and then talk about the computational theory of mind, and then we will wrap up shortly after that. So, computers were invented by Alan Turing, who was a British citizen who lived in, born in 1912, and lived in London. On the first day of school, there was a bus strike, and so he rode his bicycle alone at age 13, 60 miles to Sherbrooke. At 15, he extrapolated implications about Einstein's general theory of relativity. At 16, he apparently fell in love with a boy who died of tuberculosis and became an atheist as a result, and he studied math at King's College. He said that, "I believe at the end of the century, the use of the words of general educated opinion will have altered so much that one will be able to speak of machines thinking without expecting to be contradicted." In other words, by the year 2000, we're going to regularly have AI everywhere. Herbert Simon said that machines will be capable within 20 years of doing any work that a man can do. So much for that. That came and went in 1985. And Marvin Minsky said within a generation, the problem of creating artificial intelligence will be substantially solved. On the other hand, we've got Mitchell Kapoor, the founder of the Electronic Frontier Foundation, who said that human intelligence is a marvelous, subtle, and poorly understood phenomenon. There is no danger of duplicating it anytime soon. And Gary Marcus, who's a professor at NYU, said in the quest to create real AI, there has been almost no progress. Right? So who do we believe? There was a conference in Dartmouth in 1956 where the goal was to engineer common sense, and they figured it would take about 8 weeks to do it. So they started in 1956, and we're still trying to build common sense into AI today. What do we mean by common things, right? Well, there are lots of things that are very easy for us that computers or robots absolutely cannot do, right? So when I walk into a room, I can be like, oh, that's a person, and that's a chair, and that's a window, that's an air conditioner, that's a fan, right? Computers cannot do that, right? I can very easily walk from here to the nearest street without any problem. Robots cannot do that. They simply cannot identify objects. They cannot navigate in the world. If someone were to invent a robot that was as successful as a cockroach, right, it would be Nobel Prize winning effort, right? A lame little cockroach, right? But that lame little cockroach can navigate in its environment. It can find food. It can locate mates and reproduce. It can avoid predators. It can do a lot of really impressive stuff, common sense stuff, that we simply don't know how to build in the computers and robots yet. So common sense turned out to be a lot harder than we thought. Marvin Minsky said the brain happens to be a meat machine. This is a claim that the brain is a computer. So there have been many metaphors for understanding how the mind works over the years. Early in the Middle Ages, people thought of the mind as clay. Clay was seen as something you could make impressions on. It was malleable. It would take different shapes. And so it was thought that the mind was somehow clay. Later on in the, not the Middle Ages, but the Enlightenment period, people invented these hydraulic robots that were powered by a crush of water, and they could move around a little bit. They were put in the gardens of royalty. And people use those as metaphors for how the mind works. The mind is some kind of machine, maybe it's got hydraulic power and water in it somehow. Right? And then Turing invented the computer, and that became the dominant metaphor for how to understand the mind. Maybe the mind is some kind of computer. And that's what Marvin Minsky is saying here. Right? If we relied extensively on the expectation of logic, we'd be able to solve a lot of problems. Now, it turns out that we don't use logic very often, and we certainly don't use it to solve very many problems unless we're forced to in very manufactured circumstances, right? So think about when you get hungry and you need to get some food, right? Do you do the logical thing? Do you write out a list of all 12 million places on Earth where you could possibly obtain food, and then think about the prices of each of the options they offer, and think about what your desires for different kinds of food are, and try to optimize to maximize your utility, like economic rational choice theory says we do? No, you just say, oh, I'm hungry, and I'm, you know, kind of in the mood for some C6, so I'm gonna go to this place that I like, and I go down the street. Right? We don't use logic very often. Humans are not rational, logic-driven machines. Okay. Lafi Zada, one of my former friends and mentors, who's the inventor of fuzzy logic at Berkeley, recounted a tale of a front page article in the New York Times in 1959 that predicted that there would be a robot in everyone's home in 5 years. So we've got a prediction from Turing that AI will be everywhere by the year 2000. We've got a prediction from the New York Times that by 1964, everybody will have a robot in their home doing the dishes, mowing the lawn, doing your laundry, making food for you, right? Did that happen? No, it didn't happen. Why? Because it is extraordinarily hard to program the kinds of things that you and I take for granted. Navigating the world, grabbing objects, recognizing objects, all those things are extraordinarily difficult, way harder than everyone thought. But since then, the predictions have never stopped. And we're now in this period, the last few years, where AI has become sexy again, and everybody's making these grand prognostications. So Shane Lang, who's the chief scientist at Google DeepMind, said that human-level AI will be passed in the mid-2020s, maybe 2025. And Ray Kurzweil, who's got no shortage of exaggerations, said, I set the date for the singularity is 2045. The non-biological intelligence created in that year will be 1 billion times more powerful than all human intelligence today. 1 billion times more powerful than all human intelligence. Okay, has anybody heard of the singularity before? No? Okay, I'll tell you about it. So this is Ray Kurzweil. He's no dummy. He used to be the chief scientist at Google. He invented the first flatbed scanner, the first optical character recognition device, the first reading machine for the blind, and he won a bunch of awards. And he has made an incredible number of predictions, but predictions are hard. The New York Times said in 1936 that a rocket ship would never be able to leave Earth's atmosphere. Oops, we do that all the time now. Albert Einstein himself said in 1932 that there is not the slightest indication that nuclear energy would ever be attainable. It would mean the atom would have to be shattered at will. Guess what? Albert Einstein was the one who helped shatter the atom, you know, in 1944. Okay, what is the singularity thing that Ray Kurzweil talks about? Singularity is this claim that at some point computers will surpass human intelligence. Sometimes he says 2045, sometimes he says 2050, sometimes he says some other dates, and become conscious and even spiritual. Once they surpass human intelligence, they will accelerate past it by means of iterative recursive improvement. So at some point, computers are going to become so powerful and so much more smarter than us that they're going to start self-improving at an exponential rate, and they're going to leave us in the dust. Right? At that point, lifespan no longer applies, because we'll be able to download our consciousness, just like a computer downloads data. The human brain will be completely reverse engineered. Natural human thinking possesses no advantages over computer minds. Machines will attain equal legal status. Humans and machines will merge in the physical and mental realms, and there'll be no clear distinction between humans and machines. And most conscious beings will lack any kind of physical form, it'll just be spiritual, like data things in the cybersphere. My experience of AI is more like this, right? Where I start talking to a natural language processing system at some company, and I have to say representative like 10 times before it actually forwards me to a representative. Or when I get into my car, and it takes 14 tries for Bluetooth to connect to the speaker system, because Bluetooth is like the worst technology in the world, but we still use it. So I'm not too worried about robots taking over the world, or the Matrix happening, or the Terminator series happening, because I'm a lot more worried about trying to get my darn phone connected via Bluetooth to my car. When they can do that reliably, I'll start worrying about the Matrix. Okay, so this is a graph from Ray Kurzweil, where he purports to show the power of certain computers and correlates it with certain intelligence of animals. Right? So, you know, in the year 2000, we surpassed the spider. Then later on, we surpassed the intelligence of a lizard. Right now, we have surpassed monkeys, and we're just about to hit human intelligence with our current computers. What's the problem with this graph? Well, Ray Kurzweil is talking about number of bits processed per second, right? Or millions of instructions per second per $1,000 of cost. So the cost of processing that number of instructions per second has gone down as computing power has gone up. That's completely correct. And then he's saying that a bacteria, a spider, a lizard, a monkey, a human, all have a certain number of instructions that they process per second. Right? But the assumption there is that the human mind is a computer. Guess what? The human mind ain't no computer. There's no possible way to quantify the number of bits that the human brain processes per second, because we do not process bits. Neurons are not 0-1 bits. Right? The mind is not a computer. Right? So there's no possible way to calculate some number of bits that the human mind processes per second. Huge parts of the brain are involved in all sorts of seemingly very simple tasks. But the claim from the people who are advancing these quotes is that we already have, or will shortly have, real AI. Right? But if we already have real AI, that means that we have AI, or will shortly have AI, that works just the way the human mind works. Well, how does the human mind work? Right? What is the function of the mind? This seems like a really deep question, but I'm going to suggest that the answer is actually really simple. So this is another one of those dirty little secrets where nobody can tell you how the mind works, and there's a lot of debate about it. A lot of people have opinions. I'm going to give you my opinion on how the mind works. But first I want to give you a little thought experiment. Imagine you're an alien from a foreign world, and you land on Earth, and you find this thing that we humans call a camera, right? And there are all sorts of buttons on it, right? Including this button called an F-stop, right? I don't even know what the F-stop does. It controls the aperture in some sense to control how the photo is exposed on film, right? How likely are you to figure out what the function of that camera is, what that thing is, if you don't know what its function is, right? If you think its function is to serve as a doorstop, to keep doors propped open, you're not going to figure out what that button does, right? If you think its function is to cool the hands of the people that hold it, because it seems to be cold and it's made of metal, you're not going to figure out what that button does, right? So we're not going to figure out how it works or what that thing is until we know what its function is. And similarly, we're not going to figure out how the mind works until we know what the function of the mind is, or what is the function of the mind, right? There are a lot of answers that people have put forward. One is to perform information processing. That's what the people who believe the mind is a computer, the brain is a computer, claim that our central function is to process information. Another belief that it's to form representations of the world around us. Another belief that it's just a diverse, you know, disorganized collection of abilities. Some say that it's to help the organism reproduce, the selfish gene hypothesis. Some people say it's to serve as an executive, etc. So the claim that AI, that real AI exists or will soon exist, rests less on a claim about technology that hasn't changed in 40 years, but a lot of our claims about what human cognition is. Right? The claim is that AI is just like human cognition because human cognition is computational and the human mind is a computer. So if you believe the mind is already a computer, then real AI is very easy because we've already got these things called computers. Right? Now, this is probably news to you guys, but AI technology has not changed in 40 years. Right? So I just edited a book by Melanie Mitchell on artificial intelligence, where I read every chapter of her book before it was published and provided feedback on it. And I asked her directly, has there been any new algorithm in the last 40 years? And she said, well, you know, there's this one algorithm that they made some slight changes to, so maybe, but no. Okay, so the AI is just algorithms, right? AI is just a collection of algorithmic techniques that have a specific kind of application and process data in a certain way. So the atomic units of artificial intelligence are just algorithms, right? And you know that if you're a computer scientist, right? What do? You spend a lot of time learning very specific different types of algorithms. Guess what? There have been no new algorithms in the last 40 years, right? But we've got new things. We've got new speech recognition devices, we've got autonomous vehicles, we've got some things that are trying to identify objects, some AI systems. How are those systems doing that? There's been no new technological advance in the core of AI, in the invention of algorithms. Well, the answer is we've got more data now, right? So we've got, you know, social media, and it's possible to scrape social media and get billions and billions of pieces of data that you can train your AI system on so that it begins to discern subtle patterns and defines in that data, right? So we have lots of data now, that's what's changed, and we have slightly faster CPUs, although the CPU speed is not correlated with the expectations based on Moore's Law. We've broken Moore's Law, we are now no longer doubling CPU performance every 18 months as predicted. Okay. So this idea that the mind is a computer is really the basis upon which all these guys who are making these grand claims are suggesting that we'll have real AI soon. So the computational theory brain comes from the idea that the mind is a computer, so the mind is the software and the brain is the hardware. And our mind is just a particular kind of software that happens to run on a particular meat machine. When we figured out what that software was, we could run it on silicon, or we could run it on tin cans or anything, right? The original computer that Alan Turing invented and envisioned was based on tape, magnetic tape. So it doesn't make a difference what the medium is. The mind can run on anything, provided we figure out what kind of software it is. And popular media reinforces this idea that humans and the minds that humans have are some kind of computers, right? So we see the Matrix where it's possible to plug your brain into the machine and download an ability. I now know Kung Fu. Right? We see all sorts of examples of robots in the movies everywhere. Movies where people swap personalities, they swap souls, okay, movies with really intelligent robots. Where does this computational theory of mind come from, this idea that we are computers, right? Well, it comes from a number of different sources, which I'll just mention briefly. It comes from this idea of dualism, the mind and body are separate and distinct. It comes from a mechanistic view of the universe, that the body must be a machine and mechanistic, just like everything else in the universe. And it comes from Turing's definition of computability. Now, there's a long history there, and I could spend many, many hours just talking about the history of where this all came from and the various kinds of metaphors, but the bottom line is that the metaphor we have now is that the mind is a computer, and the brain is just a particular machine that the mind runs on. Which means, for the computational theory of mind, the brain and all the physiology is irrelevant. The brain and the body are all irrelevant. So does the computational theory of mind make sense as an answer to how the mind works, right, and what the function of the mind is? Right? So on that question, the answer is that the function of the mind must be the process of information if our minds are just computers. And my suggestion is that no, the computational theory of mind is false, and we got it wrong for the last 50 years. Right? The mind brain is not a computer. There's a great article by Robert Epstein called The Empty Brain, which I will quote from. Here's what we are not born with: information, data, rules, software, knowledge, lexicons, representations, algorithms, programs, models, memories, images, processors, subroutines, encoders, decoders, symbols, or buffers. Design elements that allow digital computers to behave somewhat intelligently. Not only are we not born with such things, we also don't develop them ever. You do not store data. Our memories are not data in the same way that a computer stores data. Minds aren't there to merely process information. Our bodies are not distinct and separate from our minds. Right? Our minds are not simply software that can be decoded. Our minds are not logic machines, nor are we purely rational. Our emotions, drives, and values are not distinct from our reason. Right? And we know this if you've ever gotten in a bad mood, or you get a cold, right? Or you get angry. Right? Or you get happy. All these things shape the kind of thoughts you have, right? When you're angry, it's weird how the whole world changes, and you can change it all, right? Now everything is really annoying, people bother you, you know, you're inclined to yell at people, right? Or if you're sick, right? Now what you think is, oh, everything's horrible, everything's painful, I just want to sleep, right? The way your body is affects your mind, and all of us know this is secret. Okay. This is what it looks like to be a pure information processing device, where all you do is process information. You ready? That's a pure information processing device that doesn't have to interact with the world, it doesn't have to navigate environments, it doesn't have to find food, it doesn't have to interact with friends, it doesn't have to go walking or running or anything else. You just sit there and process information. Okay, the biggest problem for the computational theory of mind is how to get from raw zeros and ones, or basic symbols that computers manipulate, to the point where those symbols mean something. Let's call it semantics. Right? Computers traffic in syntax. They manipulate symbols. But it is very difficult to get from the point where you're merely juggling symbols to the point where those symbols have meaning. Right? Or it's very difficult to explain what we call sense making for semantics, been impossible for computational theory of mind. So on my view, what is the function of the mind? It's to provide a powerful, flexible control system for successfully engaging the world. You're not just processing information for the sake of processing information because your mind is a computer. You are processing information in order to do things in the world. To figure out how to walk to class, figure out how to get some food, figure out how to get a degree, figure out how to take an exam. Right, you're processing information for the sake of more successfully navigating in the world. And as it turns out, cognitive science, the study of the human mind, has moved beyond this first generation attempt to understand the mind as some kind of computer to one where it thinks of what's called second generation cognitive science as embodied cognition. Right? So embodied cognition is a loose collection of research, all united around rejecting the central tenets of the computational theory of mind, namely that the mind is the software as the brain is to the hardware, and it rejects the following, right? Minds aren't there to merely process information. Our bodies are not distinct and separate from our minds. Our minds are not simply software that can be decoded. Our minds are not merely logic machines, nor are we purely rational. What does this mean? Well, for the embodied cognitivists, the body is essential to the functioning of the mind. The brain is essential. And we know this to be the case if we've ever gotten hit in the head really hard, right? It doesn't feel so good and it deeply affects our mind. So at the core of embodied cognition is this idea called simulation semantics, which where simulation semantics, sense making is easy. And the basic idea of simulation semantics is that we make sense of the world by simulating. Whereas Jesse Prince said, thinking is just seeing with the eyes closed and acting without moving. What does this mean? Well, this means that when I look at that door over there, I understand what it is. It's not just some kind of represented physical symbol that I'm copying in my brain, this image of the door. Right? I understand it because I've got thousands of experiences going through doors. I imagine myself walking the stairs, pushing on the door, maybe it's locked, or maybe it opens. Right? But I've got thousands and thousands of interpersonal experiences where I interacted with a door. And when I look at that door, I'm low-level activating all the neural circuitry that's active when I'm actually pushing open the door. Right, so I'll give you a few more examples. We know from studies that when you read a sentence about kicking a soccer ball, kicking a football, that the same parts of your brain that actually activate when you're really kicking the football are the ones that activate to a low degree when you're thinking about kicking a football or you're watching someone else kick a football. Right? So this immediately explains the semantics problem. How do we get understanding out of symbols? Well, it turns out, you know, we have experience kicking a football, right? We know what it feels like, we know how we react, we know how much pressure it takes, right? And so when we read a sentence about it, that sentence makes sense to us because we have those experiences interacting with the world and kicking a football. I'll give you some other examples. So how many windows are there in the place where you live? Right? So if you live in a house, how many windows are in the house? If you live in an apartment, how many windows are in the apartment? If you live in a dorm room, how many windows are in the dorm room? How many windows are there in the place where you live? And I'll give you a few seconds to figure it out. Okay. You got the answer? All right, how did you figure it out?
Memory?
Okay, how did your memory work? You imagined the house? Okay, what did you do when you imagined the house?
As if you were walking
around. Walking around, yeah, so that's pretty much what everybody does when they give them this example. They imagine themselves going home and walking through the rooms in the house and counting each of the windows. Like, oh, did I count the bedroom yet? Oh, no, I didn't. What bedroom, count that window, and so on and so forth. Okay, so we are able to answer that question by simulating ourselves, by imagining ourselves walking through the house and counting the windows. And the claim from second generation cognitive science is that that's how most of cognition works. We understand a door when we look at it because we low-level simulate all the past experiences that we have when we've opened a door in the past. When we're asked a question, we imagine the circumstances that the question describes and see what it's like to live in that circumstance. Right? Do you know what a jack-o'-lantern is?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, I make it on Halloween. We always make it with a pumpkin. Right? Here's a question. Can you make a jack-o'-lantern out of a grapefruit or a pomelo?
Yes.
Has anyone ever asked you that question before? No, that's a pretty weird question. Russ, you're a weird guy. Yeah, I know. Okay, so how do you answer that question? Do you check a physics textbook and try to calculate the density of a pomelo or a grapefruit and the density of a steel knife and run mathematical calculations? No, you imagine getting a grapefruit and cutting into it and thinking, oh, maybe it'll kind of keep its shape. If I cut it too much, it's not, it's going to collapse. Right? So you run through an imaginative process. You stimulate yourself engaged in that activity. Okay? And this idea that we understand the world around us by imagining ourselves in it in all sorts of ways, and we understand language by imagining what the language refers to, has got a lot of support. So these guys discovered that when you read verbs referring to actions involving certain body parts, those areas of the motor cortex in the brain become active. So that's just what we talked about with kicking a football, right? If you think about reaching for a sandwich, the very same parts of your motor cortex that are active when you actually reach for a sandwich light up in your brain, just not as strongly. Okay. They ran an experiment where they took, three groups of people, and they divided them up into the group that would practice basketball free throws in a basketball court, those that would only imagine themselves practicing free throws, and those that didn't do anything. Guess what? The people who didn't practice anything didn't do very well and should have improved. The people who practiced imagining free throws did basically just as well as the people who actually took free throws. So that imagination rewired their brains and amazingly did it in such a way that it actually improved their real free throw shots. Okay. These guys discovered that it takes longer for you to respond to a sentence that requires you to push a lever away from you if the sentence is about pulling something toward you. Okay, what am I talking about? If you read a sentence like, Andy gave me the pizza, in your head you imagine a movement like this. Someone handing you a pizza, and you take it. Now, if you're in a psych study, and in order to show that you understood the sentence, you have to push a lever forward, pushing a lever forward contradicts taking something like that. And so if you are activating the motor neurons that are responsible for going like that, that's going to conflict with the actual motor neurons you have to execute to show that you understood the question. Right? And so what they saw is that people who had to push a lever forward were slower to push the lever forward than those who had to pull a lever forward. And that makes perfect sense if what's going on is that you're imagining yourself engaged in that motor activity that's described by the sentence we're reading. Okay, subjects are also faster at tasks when presented with a picture of the object in the same orientation described in the sentence. So if I have you say, hey, tell me if anything in this picture is an object that was described in the sentence, and I say the man hammered the nail into the wall, when you see this, it's going to take you longer to respond than if you see that. Why? Because that one is closer to what you imagined than that one. Okay. Why should we care about any of this? Because the core skill that separates humans from the rest of the animal kingdom is our rich sense-making, and this is achieved by running embodied simulations. And if what we're doing, if the core function of the human mind is to run these kind of simulations, then real AI is only going to be real AI when some kind of AI system runs simulations of its own on stuff that it understands and makes sense to us, right? But the way stuff is understood and makes sense to us is by virtue of the fact that we have human bodies and we interact with the world and we touch doorknobs and we've carved jack-o'-lanterns and we walk through rooms with windows and we've hammered nails into the walls and we've kicked footballs, right? Now, computers can't have any of those experiences because they're not capable of having experience. And the amount of interaction they have in the world is very limited, right? Typically just cameras or some basic sensors, right? So until we get to the point where artificial intelligence systems can have experiences in the world and have multimodal sensory input that they can understand that means something to them, right? We're not going to be able to replicate real AI, right? So again, the main claim, we're never going to be able to build real AI until we're able to understand how human cognition works. And then how to figure out how to replicate it. It turns out that it works by simulations and embodied cognition. And so the only way we're going to be able to build real AI is if we build systems that can simulate experiences that those things have in the world and run simulations over them. And we will leave it there. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you so much. And that was like my opening presentation and talk by Dr. Ross.
And so I think we have lots of questions from the software engineering department. Any question? Yes, we can entertain maybe one or two questions from the software engineering department. Well, did you understand the presentation? So it's like, wow. Okay, like a light bulb. New idea, this is something new concept, whatever. Okay, check. Yes? Introduce yourself and shoot your question.
Hi, good afternoon, Dr. Russ. My name is Nicole Dergo and I'm from the Department of Software Engineering. Although this talk mainly dealt on AI, I was wondering if I could ask a question related to machine learning and what you know about that. That's basically my question. What can you say about machine learning? Thank you.
Sorry, I'm not sure I'm hearing you. What can I say about machine learning?
Machine learning.
Oh, machine learning.
Yes.
Got it. Okay, thanks. Yeah, so machine learning. So, how many people have experience doing any kind of machine learning stuff in the room? Anybody? Okay, so machine learning is really popular. It's one technique of AI. There are a lot of things that typically fall under AI. One is pattern recognition, object recognition, backpropagation, evolutionary algorithms, fuzzy logic, machine learning. So machine learning is a process by means of which you, using any of a variety of technical techniques, train a system based on a huge amount of data, typically to discern some kind of subtle patterns in that data, and then you provide them with live data to see if they actually learn those subtle patterns. So machine learning is really popular right now for attempting to do object recognition in pictures, for learning how to drive autonomous vehicles, and lots of other stuff. There are a lot of problems, so I have a longer AI talk where I actually go into a lot more detail about machine learning. But the bottom line is that when you feed a computer a machine learning system, using any one of the standard libraries that are out there, but a lot of really nice Python libraries make it quite easy to do this stuff as an engineer these days. The computer is finding some patterns in that data. So let's say you're trying to train the system to recognize flowers. Right? So it says, yes, this is a flower, no, that's not a flower. Okay. And it gets pretty successful so that you feed it some new images, those images have flowers in them, and it correctly says, hey, there's a flower there. Right? The trouble is, given the structure of neural networks, there's no possible way to ask the machine what criteria it's using to discern whether or not there's a flower there. It's just the way neural networks work. There's no way, there's no precise step-by-step formula. Right? The pattern that it recognized is diffuse in the weights of the neural connections that it created when it was learning. Right? And the trouble is, the things that the system learns are not at all what we learn when we learn to identify a flower. So all it takes, and I could, you know, I'm gonna bring up just a couple of slides to show you guys. So here's some examples. So here's a system that was trained up quite successfully. It did very good at object recognition. In fact, you could identify what kind of object it was. So to you and I, that's a school bus, that's a school bus. That's a temple, that's a temple. That's a dog, that's a dog. Now, it turns out it's very easy to defeat these systems that were trained with machine learning. All you have to do is add some random pixels that to us make the picture utterly indistinguishable. But here the system got it correct. It said, hey, this is a temple. And now here it says, that's an ostrich. Okay, here it said, that's a school bus. you add some random pixels that make absolutely no difference to us, and it says that's an ostrich. Add some pixels, that dog is now an ostrich. Right? So what does that show? That shows that the patterns, the things that the computer is sensitive to, have nothing to do with the kinds of things that we are sensitive to that enable us to determine what kind of object it is. So it is picking up very bizarre things regarding the pixel density and illumination and things like that. And if you mess with those little tricks that it's using, it gets all screwed up. Right? That's the lesson. In fact, it's so bad that if you just present some random pixels to the machine learning system, it'll say, that's a robin, that's a cheetah, that's an armadillo, that's a panda, that's a centipede, that's a peacock, that's a duck. Right? Of course, to us, those are just blurry static images. Right? But the thing is, we don't learn that way. We learn what a flower is because we interact in the world. We touch a flower, we smell it, we walk around it, we pick it, we pull it out of the ground. We know all sorts of things about flowers. All we're feeding these machine learning systems is digitized images, collections of pixels, and then hoping that the thing will understand what a flower is. It doesn't have any understanding of flowers. It's just detecting subtle patterns of pixel dispersion patterns from the data it's getting. Okay, you want to get scared? Here's how you get scared. So this is an autonomous driving system that was trained to identify objects like stop signs. Now, if you're building an autonomous vehicle system, you've got to get your system to identify things like red lights, green lights, stop lights, crosswalks, lane lines, all these things, otherwise it's going to drive into people or buildings and kill them. Right? So this is the same principle here. All these researchers did was to put a few pieces of tape, black tape and white tape, on a stop sign, and the machine no longer recognized it as a stop sign, but saw it as a green light. Okay? Because the machine, trained up through a machine learning system, does not actually understand the stop sign. Right? We understand stop signs. Right? It's made of metal, it's instructing us to stop before we continue forward progress. You can clank on it with a hammer, you can shake it maybe, it has some lettering on it. These things are just looking for patterns and pixels. And the means by which they were trained up to identify a particular pattern have nothing to do with the way by which we were trained to identify that particular pattern of thing that we call a stop sign. So it's really easy to defeat these things, and it's really scary to think that a lot of these things are built into autonomous vehicles. There are lots of famous stories. One was when there was a snowstorm coming in Minneapolis, and the salt trucks deposited salt on the road, right? And the salt formed, you know, kind of these white lines a little bit, but there are all sorts of Teslas out there that saw those salt lines and interpreted them as lane lines, and kept shifting lanes all over the place, trying to stay within the salt lines and trying to stay within the regular white lines, because they couldn't discern the difference. Now, to a human, it's no big deal. It's like, oh, a snowstorm's coming, so they put down some salt. The lane lines are the things that have to stay between. Those are lane lines for salt piles. But they get confused again and again, and they get confused really easily. Right? Levesque said, we need to be careful these systems are not given autonomy, appropriate only for agents with common sense, because they don't have common sense. Okay, sorry, that's a long answer to your machine learning question.
Science time? Yes. Thank you. One, we can accommodate one last question. From the software engineering. Yes. You will only have this one chance, one opportunity with Dr. Russ here.
Okay. I want to ask a question about how, instead of making AI, how about scientists who start understanding how the brain works and putting it into a machine and using it to become.
Bring the mic a little closer.
Closer to you. How about instead of creating an AI and storing data, why don't scientists do something to put a brain, like, HM machine that part
I think I get your question. Is it possible that you have the human brain put on a machine and they can work together?
Yeah. So, remember I gave you the thought experiment of a camera? Imagine you're an alien, you land on Earth, you find this thing that the humans call a camera, and you're trying to figure out what the heck it is or how it works. Right? It's really hard to figure out how something works by taking it apart. Imagine you're trying to figure out how a car works. Right? And what you do is you pull out a wire out of the car engine, pull out a wire from the car engine, and all of a sudden the car starts stuttering and going slower. And you're like, oh, that's the fast wire. That's the wire that makes the car go fast. If you pull it out, the car slows down. Well, is that the fast wire? No, that's not the fast wire. You know, you pulled out one of the leads to the spark plugs and the engine is misfiring, and that's why it's going slow. The purpose of that wire was to make the car go fast. It was to provide electricity to the valve or to the spark plug to provide a spark to ignite that particular cylinder engine. Right? So all we have when we're trying to understand the mind are these automation studies where we take things like rabbits and monkeys and stuff, and we scramble a piece of their brain, and then we see what happens to them. We're trying to figure out how it works. So neuroscience is really in its infancy. We have hundreds and hundreds of years of work ahead of us to really understand how the mind works. And it's not clear that if we even understood everything about how the mind works, that it would even make sense to, like if someone told me when my occipital lobe fires at a rate of 40 hertz per second in synchrony with my frontal temporal lobe, I have the taste of black pepper on my mouth. Then the question is, why? Why does that give me a sensation, right? So in philosophy and cognitive science, there's a problem known as the hard problem. And the problem is how any possible physical activity in your brain whatsoever could give rise to your experience of seeing a beautiful sunset or tasting a hot pepper or the feel of kicking a soccer ball really hard or kissing your wife or whatever. Right? And why did those, even if we figured out what the physical properties were, it's really bizarre to try and think about why those particular physical activities cause those conscious experiences. So, is it possible to take a brain and rig it up to all sorts of stuff? Yeah, it's possible. And we do lots of things where we took, I think it was ferret brains, like weasel brains, and we cut the connection between their visual input and their occipital lobe, and we rewired it to a completely different part of their brain. And what we discovered is that particular part of the brain started processing visual information. So one of the great myths of neuroscience is that each part of your brain is responsible for something different. So we have Broca's area, which is responsible for processing language, or the occipital area, which is responsible for processing visual information. Guess what? It's all wrong. Those decades of neuroscience got it all wrong. Why? Because it just depends on the interactions of what's connected to what. And if you connect up visual input to the area that's responsible for language processing instead of vision, all of a sudden that area becomes a visual processing region. The brain is enormously plastic and adaptable and changes all the time. And this idea that each section of the brain is responsible for some different activity is completely false. We call it the geography approach to neuroscience. So how does the brain work? We barely have the slightest understanding, but we do know one thing. It's not a digital computer, no zeros and ones.
Any other question? And so if there is none, I would like to request, I don't know, Dr. Ross to give his last message, maybe to inspire and motivate all our struggling and failing and engineering students at the College of Engineering, I don't know. Any inspiring words to leave?
I don't know if I have any inspiring words, but I would say, I'd remind you of a Steve Jobs quote who said that when he is unhappy and not satisfied doing the same thing for more than 3 days in a row, that he changes something, right? So if you're not happy doing what you're doing, figure out, try something else. Don't settle until you find something that you're excited and passionate and interested in. thanks very much for your attention and the invitation to come out here. Have a great day.
Thank you, Dr. Russ McBride. And so now, let me request the Dean of the College of Engineering for the awarding of Certificate of Appreciation to our resource person this afternoon. So I will read the text of the certificate. Central Philippine University, Center for Ideation, Realization, and Commercialization, CPU-CIRAC. Certificate of Appreciation. This certificate is given to Dr. Russ McBride, Professor, University of California, Merced, in grateful appreciation of his invaluable contribution as speaker during the roundtable discussion and lecture on what is entrepreneurship and human-like implemented AI and human problem-solving AI, held on December 13, 2018 at Central Philippine University, Haro, Iloilo City. Given this 13th day of December 2019 at Central Philippine University, Haro, Iloilo City, Philippines, signed by Engineer Danny Simulina, Project Leader, CPU-CIRAC, and the Dean of the College of Engineering, and signed also by Dr. Teodoro C. Robles, President of Central Philippine University. So once again, a big round of applause to show our appreciation. Thank you so much for the time and the sharing of expertise by Dr. Russ McBride. Thank you so much.
Thanks very much.
And we will have our group photo, so you stay put there, and then you just stand and compress together at the center, and we will have the photographer position here in front. Okay, so congrats everyone.
And Joaquin.
Joaquin.
Yes.